A lesson from the Book of Lamentations. My soul is bereft at peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. So I say, gone is my glory and my expectation from the Lord. Remember my affliction and my bitterness and the wormwood and the gall. My soul continuously thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. And great is thy faithfulness. The Lord of my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to all those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Here endeth the lesson.
Thank you. A lesson from the Gospel according to St. John. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, he who is coming into the world." Here endeth the lesson.
From whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Thank you. Please be seated. Dear friends, the purpose of a vigil or a wake in the Catholic liturgy is threefold. First of all, it's to pray for the soul of the departed on his journey to God, and we certainly do that tonight. Secondly, it's to give thanks to God for the blessing of his life, and our hearts are full of gratitude for what Carl did for all of us. And thirdly, it's to console one another in this time of loss. And especially we pray for Lois, Donna, Charlotte, and their families tonight. All of us here, all of us can pay tribute to Carl's extraordinary generosity, which he and the Lois have exercised in a manner that is so faithful to our Lord's words in the Sermon on the Mount. But please permit me to begin by giving a personal tribute to Carl's hospitality. I will never forget that Sunday. It was March 18, 2007, when I came to Walsingham for the first time in my life. I was deeply discouraged. I was searching for answers in the midst of a very difficult Episcopal Church House of Bishops meeting in Camp Allen. I walked through the door that morning, and I was looking for hope. And I was warmly welcomed by Carl, who was serving as usher. I had met Carl and Lois in the 1990s when I was serving at St. Andrew's Episcopal Church in Fort Worth, where I had the great privilege of being able to officiate at the baptism of their children, their grandchildren. That morning, I sat with them at Mass, and really, that was the beginning of my life as a Catholic. Carl never stopped welcoming folks to church, and I believe from the bottom of my heart, I believe that Carl we'll always be doing that. When we go to heaven, who do you think will be the verger? And Carl's drive was such a blessing. It was such a blessing for the ordinariate especially. I like the way that he finished college in less than 4 years while he was working full time. And this became the pattern of his whole life. Time's a wasting, or just as John Wayne said, hurry it up, we're burning daylight. And so Carl spurred us along to get things done. It's hard to imagine Carl resting eternally. You know, rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord. Carl resting? It's a mystery. We leave it in God's hands. St. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed." It was that verse from 1 Corinthians 15 that had no doubt deeply impressed the mind and the heart of the patron saint of the ordinariate, St. John Henry Cardinal Newman. In 1865, he wrote his transcendental poem, The Dream of Gerontius. It was about the journey of a faithful Catholic man to heaven. He needed some time to be purified and to be strengthened to meet the Lord face to face. And this is what the church calls purgatory. But this was mostly accomplished, Newman pictured it in his poem. This was mostly accomplished while his priest and his family were still praying at his deathbed. The priest sent him forward on his journey with that great prayer. Proficiscere, I'd sing it if I could. Proficiscere anima Christianum, de hoc mundo. Go forth upon the journey, Christian soul. Go from this world. Go in the name of God, the omnipotent Father who created thee. Go in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, Son of the living God, who bled for thee. Go in the name of the Holy Spirit, who hath been poured out on thee. The fear that Gerontius experienced at that moment was a natural fear. It was not a spiritual fear. He is not fearful of the prospect of meeting the living God. Dear angel, say, why have I now no fear of meeting him? Along my earthly life, the thought of death and judgment was to me most horrible. I had an eye before me, and I saw the judge severe even in the crucifix. Now the hour is come. My fear is fled. And at this balance of my destiny, now close upon me, I can look forward with serenest joy. And Gerontius's guardian angel says to him, it is so because thou didst fear that now thou dost not fear. Newman's poem expresses so beautifully what the Catholic Church believes comes next. The moment that Gerontius dies, his senses come fully alive. In hearing, in smell, in sight, he goes forth with the creed on his lips, firmly I believe and truly. And then his angel tells him what will happen next. There will be the searing sight of the Son of God. Christ's look will unhinge him. Gerontius will experience the double agony. Newman called it the double agony, the desire for God and the shame of his unworthiness. This will be the sharpest purgatory. And as they go forward, all around the angel are singing praise to the holiest in the height. And Gerontius can still hear the prayers of those gathered around his deathbed on earth. Gerontius breaks away from his angel because he wants to embrace Christ, but he's not quite ready for that yet. He's not quite ready for that beatific vision. And so he collapses, and he pleads to be taken away to purgatory. So the angel gathers him up and lodges Gerontius in purgatory, where the angels are singing and all the souls are singing. They're singing Psalm 90, Domine Refugium. And the angel gently tucks Gerontius away. His angel assures him that the night will pass swiftly and he will come to wake him in the morning. And all along while this happens, Gerontius is supported by masses on earth and the prayers of the faithful, both here on earth and in heaven. It's such a beautiful picture of that journey from here to there. In the faith of Christ. I had the great privilege in 2010 of being in Birmingham, England, when Pope Benedict XVI concluded his beatification homily for John Henry Newman. And he ended his homily by quoting the words that Newman placed on the lips of the choirs of angels in heaven. Praise to the holiest in the height. And I'm so grateful to Father Hoff that we have the privilege tonight of singing praise to the holiest in the height. This is what Gerontius heard, and I'm sure this is what Carl, actually, if time doesn't mean the same here, has heard. Because his future, from our point of view, is like this, and then he is in heaven forever. It's such a beautiful picture that Cardinal Newman presents to us, and I ask you now to stand as we sing this beautiful hymn, Praise to the Holiest in the High.
Especially thy servant Carl, and grant that they may be purified from all sin. my wrath may pass from glory to glory, till they come to the full light of the beatific vision, to which we beseech thee to bring us also, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Lord. On behalf of the Davis family, I want to thank you for your presence this evening at the Evensong for the Faithful Departed of Mr. Carl Davis. I'd also like to invite each of you this evening to a reception in St. Jude Hall, which is just to the west of the church. I hope you will join us there to greet the family.
Bless eternal crowns unto them all.